Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Can I request everybody to take their seat after taking their breakfast? We are about to start the program. At this moment, I will request our Imam, Sheikh Yusuf Bidad, to start the program with a recitation and a brief welcome. Sheikh Bidad.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا أوفوا بالعقود أحلت لكم بهيمة الأنعام إلا ما يتلى عليكم غير محل الصيد وأنتم حرم إن الله يحكم ما يريد يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تحلوا شعائر الله ولا الشهر الحرام ولا الهدي ولا القلائد ولا آمين البيت الحرام يبتغون فضلا من ربهم ورضوانا وإذا حللتم فاصطادوا ولا يجرمنكم شنآن قوم أن صدوكم عن المسجد الحرام أن تعتدوا وتعاونوا على البر والتقوى ولا تعاونوا على الإثم والعدوان واتقوا الله إن الله شديد العقاب صدق الله العظيم. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Indeed, this is a very blessed gathering. We are all gathered here on the theme of justice, and we know that justice is the bedrock and the foundation for every community and the global human society as well. The verses of the Quran, the teachings of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, are profound when it comes to the theme of justice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, اِعْدِلُوا هُوَ أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. Be just, for indeed justice is a means of righteousness. It's the stepping stone towards taqwa and piety. So we know that Mr. Dennis Edney, who's our chief guest, has been working really hard to acquire justice for Umar Khadr, and his work is admirable, and we are all here on this theme and to also appreciate this great work that he's rendered. And hard work always pays off, and this is something that we must note when people in the community, whether they belong to our faith or not, when they do great work, they must be appreciated, acknowledged. And when we hear firsthand from his experiences, we will understand what hurdles, what difficulties, what challenges he went through to get to this particular point. So we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all to always be just and to work towards justice. Now, it should be noted that Mr. Dennis Edney, he just told me as we were sitting and having breakfast that many times in this journey he felt alone. So we're here to tell him that he's not alone. We're here to support him. We're here to provide resources to him. We're here to encourage his great work. And we need to see more examples like this from amongst ourselves and the community at large. We're living in challenging times. We're living in difficult times, and when we strive for justice, when we put our hard work in, we might feel down, we might lose spirit, but we know that the goal is always great, and those challenges are minor. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, أَشَدُّ بَلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَاءَ ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلُ فَالْأَمْثَلُ. That the greatest difficulties and challenges, they come upon the greatest of human beings. And the Prophets were the greatest human beings, and they faced tremendous challenges. Now, I don't want to take much time because we want to hear the other speakers, in particular Mr. Edney himself. So I just wanted to leave with one remark that Mr. Dennis Edney has spent from his own wealth. He has provided his own home in many of the journeys and the travels that he makes for the cause of justice. It's from his own pocket. And there is an appeal that is being made on behalf of the Islamic Foundation of Toronto and many of the organizations and leaders that are present here, the organizers, that we want to support not only with our words of encouragement, we also want to give from our resources and our wealth. And there's a verse in the Quran that speaks about where to spend charity. It's a verse of Surah At-Tawbah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Most High speaks about the different categories and the different recipients. And in one of those categories, Allah makes a mention, وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَالْغَارِمِينَ وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, that those who are imprisoned unlawfully, you can spend from your zakah, from your sadaqah, from your charity, and use those resources to try and take those people out who are unlawfully imprisoned. And this is the exact work that Mr. Dennis Edney is doing. So we want to channel whatever resources we can towards the expenses and towards his hard work so that he can also keep in check all those expenses. So an appeal is being made, and there are different ways. If you feel your organization or yourself do not want to directly do that, you can do it through the charitable organizations, you can do it through the Islamic Foundation and many other procedures. Inshallah, Brother Waris Malik, Brother Ibad, and others that are here, they will give you all the details in regards to that. But the bottom line is, we want to support and let Brother Mr. Dennis Edney know that he's not alone in this journey. We are here, we're backing him, and we believe in justice. We want this to be the theme of this whole event, and we don't only speak about great work that he has rendered, we're also supporting financially in whatever way possible. So with these words I conclude. I want to invite on the podium Brother Waris Malik. He is a pillar of the community. He's also a board member currently of the Islamic Foundation of Toronto, and he does great work. He's one of the organizers of this particular event, and alhamdulillah, he will speak on some of the issues and the relevant matters regarding justice, as well as an introduction to Mr. Dennis Edney. So we invite Brother Waris Malik. Jazakallah khair.
Please watch the screens in front of you.
Supplicating from my lips, zindagi shamma ki surat ho khudaya meri, zindagi shamma ki surat ho khudaya meri. Take the black clouds and the dark shadows away from my light. take the black clouds and dark shadows away from our lives. Fill our world with sparkling lights. Sparkling lights, bright colors through my life. O mere dam se yuhi mere vatan ki zina. O mere dam se yuhi mere vatan ki zina. Jis tarah phool se hoti hai chaman ki zina. Jis tarah phool se hoti hai chaman ki zina. Support and protect the young and the poor. Make my life's aim to support and protect the young and the poor. Fill my heart with love. Fill our hearts with passion. O mera kaam ghareebon ki himayat karna. O mera kaam ghareebon ki himayat karna. Dardmandon se zayifon se mohabbat karna. Dardmandon se zayifon se mohabbat karna. Oh my Lord, bless us with education for a bright future ahead. Oh my Lord, bless us with education for a bright future ahead. It takes away poverty, it brings us our pride. It takes away poverty, it gives us our pride. Lab pe aati hai dua ban ke tamanna meri. All my hopes and wishes supplicating from my lips. Zindagi shamma ki surat ho khudaya meri. Zindagi shamma ki surat ho khudaya meri. Zindagi shamma ki surat ho khudaya meri.
My brothers and sisters, this is your Islamic Foundation of Toronto. All praise to Allah, the Rabb of the worlds, and the blessing and peace upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and upon his family and his companions and whoever follows his sunnah till the day of judgment. On behalf of Islamic Foundation of Toronto's board of directors, trustees, I welcome all of you and thank you for joining us today. Today, our sympathy must transcend into true empathy. True empathy is a recognition of connectivity. Recent studies in brain science and child development have found that as a human, fundamentally, we have empathy. And the gurus in self-help and also personal development have found people who are content with life are often those that contribute beyond themselves. A companion, Sahabi, came to the Prophet and complained of hunger and distress. The Prophet did not have any food. I repeat, the Prophet did not have any food. Then he asked Sahabas, his companions, that who will take this Sahabi as their guest on behalf of me? One Ansar said, I will. He took him home, told his wife, he is a guest of our Prophet. We will entertain him as best as we can. The wife replied, we only have enough food for the children. The Ansari said, put the children to sleep, and when we start eating, turn the lamp off, so the guests may not be aware that I am not participating in the meal for him, with him. The scheme worked. The whole family remained hungry to enable the guest to eat his fill. It was because of this incident that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed an ayah in Quran, which states, they prefer others above themselves, even though poverty become their lot. I repeat, they prefer others above themselves, even poverty becomes their lot. Why I am sharing this with you is to introduce a man who belongs to a different faith, but who for last many years preferred another person above himself, even though difficulty became his lot. Imagine, just imagine, if Umar walks in this room and complains of hunger and distress, would we be willing and ready to take him to our house and feed him even though our children remain hungry? Difficult question. This man not only fought for this child and a just cause, but went to an extent that he took Umar to his house and treated him like his own family, even though difficult time became his lot. My friends, I introduce to you a man of action and accomplishment, a man who believes in justice and fought for it, the man who sacrificed everything and demonstrated true empathy. My brothers and sisters, please welcome Dennis Eddy.
Thanks, Wallace. Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me here. It's been a number of years since I last was in this place, and I see old friends, friends who have along the way helped me out, friends whom I have admired and took some courage from at different times of this long journey on behalf of Omar Khadr. And I intend to talk about that journey, a journey that, regardless of your thanks, it's a journey that helped me become a far more human individual. If I were asked to turn the clock back and do this again, I wouldn't have to do all the traveling and leaving and abandoning home and family, going to hellish places like Guantanamo and so on. You bet I would. The commitment to justice helps one become a far more human and far more better individual. At least I'm working at it. Before I address Omar Khadr, it's always my policy to have some background discussion on the rule of law and the rule of law with regards to terrorism, which we hear about each and every day. It is an accepted fact that the world faces grave challenges to the rule of law and to human rights. Previously well-established and accepted legal principles are now being called into question in all regions of the world through what I would suggest are ill-conceived responses to terrorism. Many of the achievements in the legal protection of human rights are under attack, not just in Canada, but everywhere. Now, we know that terrorism poses a serious threat to human rights, and all countries, including our own country, Canada, has an obligation to take effective measures against terrorism. However, since September of 2001, many countries have adopted new counter-terrorism measures that I would suggest to you are in breach of their international obligations. In some countries, the post-September 2001 climate of insecurity and fear has been exploited to justify long-standing human rights violations that are carried out in the name of national security. In adopting measures aimed at suppressing acts of terrorism, this country and all countries must adhere strictly to the rule of law, including to the core principles of criminal and international law, and the specific standards and obligations of international human rights law, refugee law, and where applicable, humanitarian law. It is not as simply a utilitarian calculation of balancing the right to security of the many against the legal rights of the few. For when we are fighting terrorism, we are fighting for more than the safety of our citizens, though that is an important objective. We are also fighting for our preservation of our democratic way of life, our right to freedom of thought, freedom of expression, and our commitment to the rule of law. Those liberties which we have been hard won over the centuries, and which each and every one of us hold dear. So what am I saying? In my view, defeating terrorism means convincing the world of the importance of following the rule of law. And we must be alert to the extent to which governments, including our own government, continues to exploit us by using the fear card of security trumping civil liberties. Recently, the Canadian government passed Bill C-51 to allow more extensive surveillance of its citizens by its intelligence agency CSIS, stating that part of the problem is that judges have constrained the agency's powers in the names of preserving civil liberties. As an aside, I could tell you from my experience over the many years that CSIS's overview of Muslim communities is systemic from one part of Canada to the other. So I don't know why they need even more extensive surveillance powers. And that similar language used by our government was also used by the Bush administration in setting out its national defense strategy in 2005. And going to Guantanamo over the many years, I spent many years in the States under the Bush administration. And the Bush administration warned the American public, and I quote, "Our strength as a nation will continue to be challenged by those who employ the strategy of the weak by using international media and judicial processes." I could even express that even simpler. When Dick Cheney talked about locking these worst of the worst people in Guantanamo Bay, what he said was, "Leave us to take care of you. Go shopping." And in Britain, Tony Blair, former Prime Minister, on the point of leaving office, stated, "It is a dangerous misjudgment to put civil liberties first. To do so is both misguided and wrong." So here we had our own government, here we had Bush, and here we have a Prime Minister of Britain, all telling you that civil liberties are not important. Leave it to us, we'll take care of you. And I say to you, it is to our judiciary we must turn to in seeking protection of our fundamental rights and freedoms. And to those, such as I've just mentioned, who wish to suspend our civil liberties, they could have benefited from the wisdom of former US Supreme Court Justice William Brennan. In 1997, he said this, "There is considerably less to be proud about and a good deal to be embarrassed about when one reflects on the shabby treatment civil liberties have received in the United States during times of war and perceived threats to national security. And after each perceived security crisis ended, the United States has remorsefully realized the abrogation of civil liberties was unnecessary, but it has proven unable to prevent itself from repeating the same error when the next crisis comes along." We are barraged with the language of fear. Every day the phrase "war on terror" and the word "terrorist" has now become synonymous with Islam and Muslims in the minds of many. And my long journey, it's hard to shock me. But recently, a friend of mine, a Muslim friend of mine in Edmonton, said to me that his young boy came up to him and said, "I'd like to change my Muslim name." What that struck me to the core, because what it said to me was the systemic profiling of Muslims has now reached to the schools and to our children. So as we are barraged every day with the language of fear, the language of terrorism, the language of war on terror that has come synonymous with Islam and Muslims, it is much easier then for people to accept that we need to enact drastic measures in the interest of our security, even if it means the suspension of civil liberties, even if it means the compromising of our values, or even ignoring the rule of law, because we rationalize out of fear. It's for the greater good of society. And as you're aware, after 9/11, Muslims in the United States were rounded up and incarcerated without access to lawyers or their loved ones. And since then, Muslims, in my view, have been made to pay a terrible price for the actions of 19 fanatics who in no way represented Islam or its values. Afghanistan and Iraq were bombed and invaded as a direct consequence of 9/11. And over a million men, women and children have been killed in those countries. Untold numbers maimed, widowed and orphaned. And one has to look no further than the story of Guantanamo Bay to understand how easy it is for a nation to fall into lawlessness. It was in January of 2002, each and every one of us witnessed on television, on various media outlets, the first shocking images of detainees being hooded, shackled, but transported across the Atlantic to Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, such as other human beings had been carried in slave ships 400 years earlier. And prior to their departure, they were deprived of food and water to ensure they did not use the toilet facilities on the plane. I remember my first time, or one of my first times, going to Guantanamo speaking to Omar, and he said, you know, Mr. Redney, before we got transported on these planes, we only got sips of water for days prior to leaving, and we got no food. And then I did an inquiry, and it was to ensure that toilet facilities were not used on the planes. Think about that. Think about, I have two dogs. We love dogs, we love pets. If I had treated my pets like I had treated those human beings, there have been complaints about me. I've been brought before a court. And prior to before their departure, they would be zipped up, and you've seen the images of the one-piece orange jumpsuit as these detainees were made to be shot shackled and lie in fetal positions or squatting positions for the 24-hour trip to Guantanamo Bay. I have been in those transport planes sitting. They're incredibly uncomfortable. I can't imagine lying on the floor for 24 hours in one position, bouncing up and down. But while they were there, what else did we do? We covered their eyes and their ears with goggles. And then we put hoods over their faces. What was the message we were sending? Well, the message we were sending was, they are no more, they are not human beings. They're just simply luggage. Because on their arrival at Guantanamo Bay, they would be unloaded on the tarmac of the airport like so much baggage, and then picked up like so much baggage and transported to the wire cages of Guantanamo, 6 feet by 6 feet seven. My dogs have much more room to move around in. And that was to be their home for many years, irrespective of tropical storms or searing heat. And for the watching world, which includes you and I, no knowledge of international humanitarian conventions was needed. You didn't need an education to understand what you were witnessing. And what you were witnessing was something that was unlawful. This was not the manifestation of the Geneva Conventions at work, nor was it an act of deportation or extradition. It was far, far worse. It was the unlawful transportation to a world outside the reach of the law and intended to remain so. and it continues to this present day. And in that world of Guantanamo, crimes against inhumanity were to be carried out. And amongst those detainees was a young 15-year-old Canadian, Omar Khadr, abandoned in Guantanamo Bay by a government when every other Western government requested and were granted return of their citizens from Guantanamo Bay, adults each and every one of them. Now digress for a moment, hopefully I don't digress too far, but it was the fact that Omar Khadr was a child that resonated in me. I'm a criminal lawyer. I've done all kinds of cases. I understand adults. I understand adults need to be punished. But to abandon a child in a hellhole called Guantanamo Bay when our government had the opportunity to have him released and brought home was just wrong. And in that hellish place of Guantanamo, we have witnessed the videotapes of a young Canadian boy, Omar, crying out for his mother after telling Canadian interrogators he had been tortured and that he was frightened of the Americans. It took me 5 years to get that tape recording and put it before the Supreme Court of Canada. And the Supreme Court of Canada ruled that Canada had participated in the torture of Omar Khadr along with the CIA. I fought 5 years to get that out. And when I woke up the next morning, naively I expected the world to change for me. And there wasn't the slightest bit of concern raised by the Canadian public that our government had been complicit in the torture of a child, a Canadian kid. Imagine that. If we can do that to one kid, then who else is safe? And in his 10 years at Guantanamo, Omar has been subject to a range of torture. And whatever torture he has suffered, every other detainee in Guantanamo gets the same treatment. We're an equal opportunity employer. We give you all the same treatment. The litany of abuses of Omar ranged the gamut from waterboarding to the crucifixion, which I call a crucifixion. I remember at the trial, the so-called trial of Omar Khadr, and I digress again, I can tell you that I may have been ashamed of my behavior as I was growing up, but you'd have to speak to my mother and father about that. I've never felt ashamed of my role as a lawyer until I participated in that kangaroo court in Guantanamo Bay. And I recall a nurse from the Bagram Hospital where Omar was detained after he'd been unconscious for a week. And when he woke up, little did he know that his troubles had only started. And so I asked her about the mistreatment of Muslims in that particular hospital and the deaths of many. And she said, no, everything was fine there, no problem at all. And then I got this soldier who was in the hospital. And he talked about witnessing Omar Khadr being stretched up in a crucifixion pose, tied to wires, 15 years of age, your son, crying, screaming, and being humiliated by soldiers as they're looking at this child up there in a crucifixion pose. And when he peed himself, that was great, because then we untie him, we bring him down, and then we use his head to wipe up the urine. Evil is a word I rarely use, but Guantanamo and the treatment of peoples, especially a child, in the most sacred places that I think of hospitals are, is evil. And he was also subject to all kinds of other treatment. One that particularly bugs me, it's small in the sense of the overall abuses he and others experienced, was the particular soldier who every day would come into the ward, drop his pants, stick his bum in Omar's face and fart. And what was interesting about that was the nurses and the soldiers just laughed. It was fun.
Yeah,
very similar. Fun. In fact, you should go onto YouTube and listen to Damien Corsetti. Damien was 20 years of age when he was part of an interrogation team that questioned and tortured people like Omar Khadr. And just recently I listened to him. And what did he say? He said if he regretted is the harm he gave to Omar. And he was asked, well, what would you say to him if you met him today? And he said, I'd say I was sorry. And I've met Damien, and he has a tough time living with himself. He has a nice tattoo on his tummy that says, I'm a monster. But he was just a youth. He was 20 years of age. Sergeant Claus, who was the chief interrogator, the chief torturer, he killed one detainee and crippled two others in that same ward, using the same interrogation methods that he used on Omar Khadr. But at the trial in Guantanamo, he acknowledged that he was a bit, you know, rougher on Omar than others. I don't know how much rougher you can be, but what does it suggest to you when a human being enjoys abusing a child more than an adult? And all that evidence was not allowed in. No evidence of torture was permitted by this wonderful judge in Guantanamo Bay. And so and Omar Khadr, in his time, he's been subject to prolonged sensory deprivation, profound long-term isolation, hooded, short-shackled, kept in stress positions for lengthy periods, deprived of sunlight for months, and observed by cameras round the clock. And And that sums up the imagery of the Omar Khadr I saw for the very first time. I've always described it. Well, let me step back. When I went to Guantanamo Bay, I was kind of excited. This was something different. And so I arrived in Guantanamo Bay as a lawyer. But I left Guantanamo Bay as a very sad father, because at the time I had two young children. And at that time when I arrived in Guantanamo Bay, Omar Khadr was not in the cages. The cages to Omar was like a holiday. He was in one of the secret prisons in Guantanamo that the Pentagon describes as used for enhanced interrogation techniques. Can use your imagination to consider what that means. Torture. And I recall walking into this gloomy cell with no windows, and here was a boy chained to a floor. And I remember sort of gasping because he had withdrawn into himself. And he reminded me of a small little bird. He appeared broken everywhere. He had all kinds of injuries, and he was frozen. He was sort of shivering. Because, as I learned over the years, cells are kept frozen, are kept cold, so that you never get the chance to rest. And it was there that I made some grandiose statement to him on leaving 3 days later. He had said to me as I was leaving the cell, he said, "You will leave me. Everybody does." And in a grandiose way, I said, "No, I won't. No, I won't." I had no idea what I was talking about. I hadn't got a clue. I had no idea that I would take on the American government, the Canadian government, and the so-called process in Guantanamo. I just knew I had to do something. And when I talk about Omar Khadr, I wish to remind you that I'm also talking about every other detainee in Guantanamo. Guantanamo, in my view, is a propaganda coup. And I can justify that quite simply. Because if the most evil people in the world, the most horrible of terrorists, are locked up in Guantanamo, and you consider the international criticism of Guantanamo as a torture center, we would have had trials. We would have put all those most evil people up. In fact, of the 900 people that have been in Guantanamo, there have been 3 trials and 3 plea bargains. And one of the first trials was Omar Khadr. And I remember saying to somebody there, if he is the worst of the worst, then he must be the top Taliban leader. Is that it? This 15-year-old kid? It's a fiction. It remains a fiction. And I continue to say that people who are in Guantanamo are innocent until you prove them in a proper court of law and provide them with the necessary evidence. That will never happen. It can't happen. Because it's a fiction. And in that place of Guantanamo, it was a common sight for me to observe a detainee shot, shackled, and wearing black goggles and earmuffs to block out all light as he had been taken away to an interrogation session. He knew what he was going to be faced. I knew what he was going to be faced. Interrogation sessions were numerous, consistent. And in that hellish place, many detainees arrived as young men. And after years of isolation and abuse, they had become old and weak men, physically. And it was my first introduction to Islam. As a person who, unlike my wife, I don't consider myself Christian. I'm not here to talk about my faith or not my faith. But I couldn't, over the years, not have such admiration for Islam. The belief in their faith has helped the many of these detainees to put up with some of the most horrible horrors. Their faith has kept many of them alive. And Omar Khadr is an example of that. Because Omar Khadr has showed the Canadian public just very recently just how human he is, and not the image of fear that governments have wanted you to understand for years. Guantanamo is a place shut off from the rest of the world. simply forgotten and abandoned. With the exception of a half dozen detainees, the remainder of the many detainees have never been charged with a crime. They have never had any access to a lawyer or permitted a consular visit. And the memory of their family and their children is a distant image, as no visitors are permitted there. In fact, Omar didn't know his father had been killed until about a few years later in Guantanamo. They are just simply lost and abandoned in a black hole called Guantanamo. And so, as I moved from Guantanamo, there was a point I reached where I realized that Omar Khadr was going to spend the rest of his life there. When I arrived in Guantanamo, you should understand that I was viewed as a nice guy, the nice Canadian. And then I'm a trial lawyer. And then I started looking at the quality of your work, if any. I turned up for trial, and the military lawyers were at the beach swimming. I had spent a summer arranging for all kinds of international witnesses to come to Guantanamo Bay, and I was told it would come. I had David Crane, special US prosecutor for the Sierra Leone trials, who said at his own expense he would come. Many others all agreed to come and talk. And not one single witness was there for Omar Khadr. Your government knows that. That's why I always say that to them. They know everything I know. They also know that I said to a Department of Foreign Affairs official one day, if we don't get him out of that secret prison, he will die. And that person agreed with me. And so, I persuaded Omar to take a plea bargain. The Americans, contrary to your understanding, wanted Omar out of Guantanamo much sooner. Our government refused to participate. And so Omar Khadr was not interested in pleading guilty because I recall what he said. He said, people will think of me as a terrorist. And I said, no, they won't. When the Canadian public see you and hear you, they will admire you for your humanity. And so I provided all kinds of documents to the Canadian government showing from the Pentagon to psychiatrists and psychologists that Omar Khadr had no ideological leanings, and the judge advocate that had been in charge of the camp described him as a good kid. Our government, on Omar arriving home, described him as a danger, not only to Canada, and this is what makes me laugh, and to every other prisoner and every supermax prison in Canada. He really was the evil. He was the horror story that Dick Cheney passed out about all those detainees. And so what do? He gets put into Mill Haven Maximum Institution, where serial killers are. He gets locked away for 7.5 months in isolation. And on the day we let him out, the guards put him on a food line and told him he had only to provide one piece of butter to each prisoner. Serious prisoners. And this innocent young man refuses to give more than one piece of butter to a particular prisoner, who then decides he's going to stab him because he's standing up to me. And I used that experience with a little bit of a deal that I wouldn't go to the media if we could transfer him to Alberta. So I got him transferred to Edmonton Max. And what do you do with a young Muslim when you transfer him to another prison? Of course, you put him on a white supremacist unit, where he got beaten up within the first 5 minutes. And then that was probably the worst time of my experience with Omar. I'd never seen him cry until that day. And the warden was so scared of what was happening to him, called me in to see him. And it was the worst day because I had persuaded him things would be fine in Canada. And it was then that I realized I couldn't protect him. I couldn't take him home. He was going back upstairs where those white supremacists were waiting to beat him up again. And so, history tells us that some cases enshrine the defining moments of their time. Omar Khadr's case is one. Future generations will rightly judge our shocking dereliction of responsibility in this matter and our collective failure to extend justice and humanity. And as we have all failed Omar, we have also failed our children through bequeathing to them an uncertain future as a result of systemic apathy by our citizens and its institutions. And so as I close, I have described myself recently as I feel like John the Baptist, 11 years in the desert, and now I'm embraced back to the village. The journey, as was mentioned, can be pretty lonely. It can be pretty demanding. It's you look for cheap hotels so you could keep your enough money to get through what you have to do. And I've never resiled from what I was doing was right. And although you thank me for my work, you should be thanking my wife. My wife without a complaint, has scraped monies year after year after year after year to ensure that I can continue my work. And so as I conclude and I stand before you here, I hope you all saw the press conference. As a criminal lawyer, I never talk about my clients in such glowing terms. Omar Khadr is special. Omar Khadr is a triumph of human rights. Omar Khadr has used prison as a monastery. He has become, his faith is powerful and his humanity is strong. The irony that we don't face is that when we abuse people and torture people, and I've mixed with lots of torture victims, unfortunately, they're not angry. I know it's hard to believe, but they're not angry. They don't want to come after you with a gun. What do they want? They want what Omar Khadr said to me years ago. He's sitting in a cell. I said, what do you want to do when I get you out of here? He said, I want to be a doctor. I said, why? He said, because I wish to ensure that no one is ever mistreated as I've been. And so he has returned to Canada. I called my wife yesterday to see how he was doing. We had bought him a bike. And she said, I can't get him off the bike. There's no greater symbol in my mind of freedom. I forgot about it when I was a child. You get on that bike, and away you go. You've got no parent standing over you. It was highly symbolic of freedom. And I give to you, and I ask for your help, because we have returned to society someone who turns that whole logic, that whole imagery of how Muslims are bad people. Thank you. Thank you very much.
My brothers and sisters, you have listened. Although the title of this event was Story of Umar Khadr, actually it's the reality of Umar Khadr. And we have known the facts now. As Dennis spoke about his wife, I think very rightly, on behalf of all of you, not Islamic Foundation, but on behalf of all the Muslim community of Greater Toronto Area and beyond, in appreciation of outstanding dedication and devotion by Patricia Edney for her commitment and steadfastness in respect of justice, freedom, truth, hereby present this small token of appreciation to say her thank you. I would like to thank our Sheikh, actually. We should clap for him also. He flew all the way from Vancouver this morning. He was there in Vancouver yesterday, and today he's flying back to Vancouver. I'll request at this stage Ibad to come on the stage. Ibad has been instrumental in organizing this program and getting Edney to Toronto and other places. So I'll ask Ibad to come and say a few words, please.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. First of all, I wanted to thank the Islamic Foundation of Toronto for their generous support. And as you can see, the organization, the infrastructure, the support of the Majlis and the community at large. I called the Islamic Foundation about 3 weeks ago after I'd had a chance to meet Dennis at a friend's house and heard the story and wanted to know what we could do to further the cause and to help him and to help what he's done. And I called Waris Malik. It was actually about 11:50 at night, and I texted him. I was just working. I said, Waris, why can we talk about this? Because I know he was very active and very involved, not only 8 years ago, but continuously over the past number of years. And Waris called me within 10 minutes, and he said, let's do this. He said, let's get Dennis, let's get a date, let's get him to come to this Toronto, and let's have a session for him, right? It's that kind of support where not only do we as a community appreciate what the work the foundation has done, but as a broader cross-spectrum of Muslims, we really do appreciate where we take a stand and work for a greater cause and greater purpose. So, to the foundation, thank you. The second is to all of you. I know many of you have received emails from myself or phone calls and sort of, you know, through other third parties and word of mouth, and not one person who I contacted told me they couldn't make it for any other reason except for the fact that they were busy and previously engaged. So it's a testament, actually, to how we view and how important we view this issue to be. So thank you for coming and making time, taking time away from your families and previous engagements. I know it's not easy at Saturday morning at 9 a.m., but thank you. And most importantly, to Mr. Dennis Edney, I don't need to say much, and I don't think I can add much more to what he's already said. But there's one thing I did want to sort of read for you. It's an interview, or a bit of an interview, that was done by Stephen Zhu in the Islamic Monthly. And the title of the piece was titled "The Passion, the Passion of Dennis Edney for Omar Khadr." And I mentioned this to Dennis a few minutes ago, and if Stephen did any injustice to it, it's Stephen's fault, it's not mine, I'm just reading from it. But the piece that I wanted to read is, this talks about Dennis and when he was speaking to various audiences. And it says, when the audience clapped for Edney during his talk, he would close his eyes slightly and raise his hand at them, as if to say, I don't come here for applause. He talked about how he was given awards from all sorts of law societies, who gave him standing ovations from coast to coast every time he talked about his favorite subject, Omar Khadr. Yet, nobody from those audiences ever contacted him to give him any serious support. For all the money he spent out of his own pocket, for every award, every standing ovation he got, and for every lecture he gave from Toronto to San Francisco to Yale University to New York, no real political action seemed to follow. There are times when I've prepared speeches for Omar, he said, to say that I'm not coming back. But I can't. There are times in life when you simply don't walk away, he said. And this is Stephen's words, where he said, I don't know many words that ring louder in my head today than those. And this is Dennis's word. These are Dennis's words. And I keep on looking for that Muslim voice. Right. Today we're here because we want to let Dennis know about that Muslim voice. And for those of us who have supported in the past and contributed, may Allah reward you for your efforts. For those of us who can make a difference today and going forward, for not only for the work Dennis has done in the past, but for also the work that he'll need to engage with going forward, it's time for us to show our support. Dennis has incurred significant financial hardship fighting this battle, at significant financial detriment to himself and his family and his children. Foregoing any discussion about legal fees and what he otherwise should have earned from this case, forget that. Just the out-of-pocket expenses alone are huge. What we need to do today is come together, and for those of us who have already contributed, thank you. For those of us who are wanting to contribute and are here today, you can contact Waris or myself, we'll be here. You can write checks, give us cash, we'll make sure tax receipts are issued, and we'll make sure everything goes to Dennis to continue the battle. So with that, I think we have a few minutes left because we have a little bit of reconfiguration to do in this room, because as you know, there's an open forum that's going to be starting at 11, but maybe we can take 10 minutes or so of questions. And then to that extent, then afterwards we can wrap up and get the room ready, and for those of us, we can mingle for a few minutes. So we'll open the floor, Dennis, is that okay, for 10 minutes or so? Perfect. So any questions? Samim. You might just have to speak up.
So if I don't speak, just write up 100,000 right now, it's good. I'll pledge $5,000.
Thank you, Samim. Jazakallah. I'll follow up with you for that. Thank you. Any other questions? Brother.
One question. What is the political party's role? Quite a fair role for the political
party. I'll repeat the question. So, brother, the question is, what was the role of all the political parties in this and not repatriating Omar Khadr earlier?
Well, that's a good question. Excuse me. I don't have the answer to that. I know that the NDP and the Liberals have made comments in Parliament, but I've not had a call from a single MP anywhere. And so that says a lot about those who are there to, as our representatives, to go to Parliament. And they still haven't done anything. I hope that answers the question.
Any others?
I'll repeat.
In the very start, you mentioned that many civilized countries, you know, they are adopting, or they are continuously adopting the resolutions and laws in the name of anti-terrorism. And there is open discrimination between the civil liberties, fundamental rights, and human rights. Now, when I look at the trend...
Brother, can you just sort of speak up? Sorry, just maybe come a little closer, if you don't mind.
When I look at these trends, you know, changing the civilized societies and the leadership satisfaction. What the Prime Minister of in the office in the world said, okay, equally machines is power business. One of the superpower has established a place where they can go to a knowledge very easily, right? So looking at the trend, how do you gain this trend? Because who are making these laws? The leadership, the legislative SMBs, and the top class lawyers. How do you use the trend? And how the things are going to be landed in the future? Because they say, this is the beginning.
Did you get any of that?
No.
So I think for those who didn't get the question, and I think it's actually a very telling question, which is really sort of taking into account the way things have gone and what countries have done, particularly in light of what the establishment of Guantanamo and laws that seem to aggregate our civil liberties. What is it that you see coming, and what is it that we can do to make sure that we work against this for the future?
That's a complicated question. It would take a long time. But let me tell you, we have power. We feel powerless. I know that. But I'd say very often, particularly to youths, that I'm a powerful guy, that I have taken on governments, and I'm just a little guy from Scotland who came to Edmonton. And I believe that, absolutely. And what makes me powerful is I'm fighting for something you can't argue against, justice. And I use law to temper power. And so I bring those two factors together. So I'm hard to attack. Do I say it's easy? Not at all. But if I can do it, then you can do it. And one of the frustrations I've had over the many years, and I've related that, is that you are powerful. You Muslims are powerful. You are bound together through your faith. You're bound together actually through your prayer, because you pray five or four times a day. You're in a constant community. You have such power to change for the better. And you should use that, and you can use that. And don't worry about what's coming down. We will always be challenged by what's coming down. We know that systemically, we know that historically, we pick on particular groups, whether it's the Jews or the Russians or whoever. They were the axis of evil, I think Russia was described by Nixon, etc. And now we don't really actually say that all Muslims are terrorists, but we imply that. How can we not think that? And so you can challenge that. You can make your politicians accountable. Why give a vote to a politician who won't stand up and challenge that language?
I want to make two comments. Number one, first of all, thank you, Dennis, for your excellent presentation. I want to appeal to the Muslim communities that I think it's time that you shed your fear. Unfortunately, the Muslim community lives in fear. 4 years ago, we had invited Dennis and our center. I don't think any of you are present over there. A few of us, but nobody else. So I think we need to shed our fear and stand up for our rights. If you don't, you're going to be walked over all over. Yes. Nobody will give a damn about you.
Yes.
Second, I think it's important, as the brother said, Dennis has made a hell of a lot of commitments from his own pocket. I don't think anyone of you has ever done anything like that. Let's put our money where our mouths are. Let's pledge to Dennis and his cause right now. Don't walk away from it. And I want to back this brother and said, we from our society will pledge $10,000. I want to see everybody.
We need to wrap up. We have two questions, maybe a third. Sorry, so
that's a gem of that.
We'll see, Funko, you'll be the last one. Wait, first, go ahead. Wait.
Sir, I had the pleasure of meeting you a few weeks ago at my friend's house, and since that time I've redefined my definition of what a hero is, and you definitely fit that description. bring back to a few of your comments regarding the power of our community and what we can do as Canadians and as Muslims. Can you comment exactly how, as a collective, we can enact change? Something practical. Is it to be engaged in the political process? If so, how?
It's a long conversation. A million ways. I talked about the example of lobbying your politicians to stand out, not to promise, but to stand up and rectify the abuses to your reputation, one. You could support me and people like me in doing legal challenges. I was involved in a legal challenge in New York on a peripheral basis where the Center for Constitutional Law of New York sued the New York Police Department for profiling Muslims. At the second level of the federal court, they were successful. There are times you should have been in court challenging the message about Muslims. There are different ways. Justice. We have to discuss what justice means better. Justice means, and there's no better group in my view than Muslims who understand justice. That's why you're here this morning. No one dragged you out.
How can we take our politicians to task? Would you encourage us to engage the political process by voting?
Absolutely. I was in a mosque not so long ago where, I'll be careful, where the manager was promising votes to the PC party in Alberta. You know? And so, and I remember asking, what are you getting for that?
So we're just going to wrap up with this last question, Asif, sorry, you can come afterwards. With the last question, and then after that, we just need a little bit of time to reconfigure, but also at the same time to make sure that those of you who are here as representative of your institutions, that before you leave, you've talked to Waris, and those of you individually, and we do request that, and humbly request that you do contribute to see me. I won't leave till I've talked to whoever of you that need to contribute. For those of you who haven't brought checks or donations, we're happy to come and pick them up for you. That's no concern or no issue. So if you could make that pledge and if you could give us that donation today, that would be very much appreciated. So with that, we'll take the last question.
I don't have a question, but a comment and an appeal.
What a surprise to see something.
Dennis, we are indebted to you. Our hats off to you. Thank you very, very much. I'll give you my own example. Paul Kalendra, my MP, has not been now, he's running away from me because I've been after his case for so long. Please do that.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We'll just like to wrap up because we have another program which will be starting at 11 o'clock, which is an open forum. You are most welcome to join that and stay. That's an open forum from 11 o'clock to 1 o'clock. As Ibad said, that if any there are any organizations who want to contribute, please see me, and individuals, please see Ibad. At this stage, we'd like to thank each and every one of you for coming out, staying with us, having a breakfast with us.